my dear colleagues to our fifth International Eurasian Congress. We are now in the third session. We are going to listen to six valuable work, oral presentations in diverse areas of our culture. First of all, let me introduce myself. I am associate professor in Necmet Narbakan University, Molecular Biology and Genetics Department. I am dealing with the genomics part of the plant science. If it's possible, please introduce yourself shortly before the presentation to the audience and also for our colleagues, and then start our presentations and proceed. Now, in our schedule, we have six presentations, but we have a change. We are going to start with the identification of candidate-resistant gene orthologs in carrot through bioinformatic analysis. We are going to listen to Dr. Ayşe Özgürüncü. Let's start.
Okay, then. So let me share my screen first. Let's see. Sorry. Okay. So is my screen visible to you all?
Yes, we can see it, I think. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Let me introduce myself as well. I am Ayşe Özgürüncü from Necmettin Erbakan University Faculty of Science Department of Biotechnology. And my expertise is also in plant genomics and bioinformatics. And the work that I will be presenting to you right now is also a bioinformatics approach in order to determine the set of orthologous resistance genes in carrot, as we can see from the title. So a very brief introduction to warm up to the subject, a few sentences about carrot. It's a diploid plant, and we know that it's one of the most economically valuable Apiaceae members because it is a highly cultivated horticultural crop. It's one of the 10 most cultivated vegetable crops indeed. And also the production rates are constantly increasing during especially the last decade. And the rate of acceleration in production is actually much higher than other vegetable crops. There are some reasons to that. For example, the increased demand, especially for ready to consume clean and cut products as a healthy snack. And also development of new cultivars, which are adapted to different climatic conditions, also significantly contributes to the increased production rates. And today I will be talking about the resistance gene identification issue in carrot. As we all know, all horticultural crops and field crops are disease susceptible to several type of pathogens, fungi, bacteria, insects, nematodes, and etc. And we know that our genes, as the mediators of plant innate immune responses, they mediate the response to invading pathogens. And the primary mechanism that we know is the interaction of the RGM products with the products of the virulence genes that are expressed by the invading pathogens. Okay, the next slide. We all know that pathogens evolve rapidly, actually, and break resistance rapidly as a consequence. But plant immunity evolves rapidly as well. and the there is a huge level of diversification in our genes. We know that these genes exist in plant genomes in clusters. There are many copies of our genes in plant genomes, mainly due to segmental duplications, which increases the copy number. And also retrotransposon activity also increases the copy number of our genes. I mean, this activity acts on mRNA and the activity reinserts the mRNA in plant genomes, which results in increased copy number of our genes. And these, the resultant clusters are selected for in plant genomes. And also unequal crossing over between similar alleles, similar loci. And then gene conversion during meiosis also acts positively on divergence and increased copy number of the R genes, which actually all are beneficial for plant resistance because alternative resistance specificities occur as a result of this. So this is good. Dynamic nature, the evolution of resistance is of course good. So gives the plants new chances to adapt new resistance strategies. Did something change in the screen? I think yes. So.
Because now we are seeing Muhsin Yıldız.
Yes, I see. If I press share screen again, maybe I can switch.
Let me. Yeah, I think.
I will try that. Okay. Well, yes, yeah. Yes. It says this will stop other screen sharing. I say yes.
Yes. Yes.
Uh huh. Yes.
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. Okay, so I think we established that resistance genes are really high in copy number in plant genomes, which is beneficial, as I said. I will now get into the my main subject, which is the computational biology part of the subject. We know that genomics and bioinformatics really has a lot of new developments lately during the last two decades, actually, because there are high throughput sequencing technologies really developing, and also new data analysis approaches are also being developed. And as a result, we actually have the chance to share our data with the entire research community through open data repositories, open yet curated repositories. And so, as I said, all can access to large amount of data who are interested in, who are studying bioinformatics. And also gene identification has came to a new level with new functional annotation and ortholog identification strategies, which can sometimes be de novo. From scratch, we identify new genes or based on sequence homology with previously identified genes. Our topic subject is our genes, and we know that these genes are modular. They have different, domains, and different combinations of these domains give rise to different R gene classes. We know that there are at least these classes exist, the CNL, TNL, RLP, RLK classes, and the domain types I have listed here. For example, for the CNL class, we see coiled-coiled domain, nucleotide binding domain, and loosened-rich repeat domain. These domains exist at least once in a CNL class R gene, but of course, more than one, for example, coil domain can exist in a CNL class RG. So the modularity also gives rise to new chances of resistance to RGs. As I said, de novo and homology-based annotation strategies are both feasible. And in our work I'm describing, we used both strategies sequentially to be on the safe side of, I'm getting rid of false positive results, let me say. And the input data we used was the carrot transcriptome, which encompasses more than 30,000 different unique cDNA sequences. These are all expressed sequences. And we used them to for the structural annotation because the available algorithms act actually on coding sequences, so we only need the exons, not the introns. And then what we did was first run a pipeline of de novo structural annotation, which searches for the domains listed up on the slide, like the kinase domain or leucine-rich repeat domain. And once locates these domains, then identifies the sequence as a positive hit to encode for an RG. And then what we did was to narrow down the results using a homology-based approach, which means searching the database of experimentally validated R genes, which can display high degree of similarity with our positive hits that we obtained from the de novo structural annotation approach. And for this, first, we use the ensemble plants database to retrieve the transcriptome collection, and then the Drago pipeline I have written on the slide, which we can also reach this pipeline, download it and run it from the plant resistance gene database website. It's available, freely available, the pipeline. And then for the homology search, we use the collection of the reference plant resistance genes, which is total of 153 experimentally validated plant R genes. And as a result of the structural annotation, the de novo annotation, up to 10,000 R gene domains were identified in the carrot transcriptome. And as I said, these, for example, in the first column here in the larger table, the codes belong to the cDNA sequences. And we, for example, see in this rectangle that I mark, the same code, you know, you see having more than one domain, for example, two coil domains, two kinase domains, all in the same sequence. So from here, we can deduce that this R gene has at least four identified domains for resistance. And when we, you know, filter the data for unique cDNA sequences, we end up with 1,644 putative R genes. And we see from the smaller table here that we see a lot of transmembrane domains, which is actually an anticipated result because these will act in signaling, I mean, receive signal from the outside and transmit it to the cytosol. So this was an expected result. And then what we did was, as I said,
You can show it from the PowerPoint, maybe. I think it's stuck.
Yes.
It's already open.
For how long?
Sorry, we huh. Need.
Sorry. I will share the screen again. May I ask on which slide were we when the audio?
Yes, we can see that. You can proceed.
Huh. So while I was talking about the results of structural annotation, was it possible for the audience to hear me?
Yes, we hear all.
Okay. Do I have to, repeat the results?
You can proceed to sixth, I think, slide.
Okay. Next slide. Okay. So, as I said, the structural annotation step gives us a list of a pool of putative candidates, but it's safer to narrow down our results also with a consecutive homology-based approach because all of with the advantages of these pipelines, these statistical methods, they also, like any other procedure, may have some drawbacks, which the de novo annotation strategies may sometimes produce a higher rate of false positives. So to be safer, we also apply the homology annotation process, which used, as I said, 153 experimentally validated plant R genes, which means that we are sure that those are R genes. And as a result of that search, we identified more than 935 unique resistance gene orthologs, which are expressed by the chiral genome. This may look like a very high number, but that is the fact about the resistance gene family. As I said in the beginning, they are high in copy number in plant genomes because they are evolutionarily selected for, since this is also an advantage for that species. And this corresponds to a total of, the homology corresponds to a total of 60 experimental validated R genes. That was actually an anticipated result as well, because we know that the type of R genes in the chiral genome may not be that diverse compared to some other species. And what could be done next after, being able to identify these set of orthologs in the chiral genome could be developing a high throughput sequencing strategy on phenotype populations, in order to, for example, determine a set of resistance alleles, to use in marker-assisted selection programs, which could be beneficial for both breeding superior cultivars and also for less spraying the plants, using less pesticides, insecticides, which also contributes both to human health and the environment. So I would like to, thank you all, for sharing the session and the information. And I'm done for now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. This is a very good presentation and important subject. Meeting with the plant genomics and bioinformatics with the carrot resistant gene orthologs. Thank you very much for this. We don't have any question, so we can, I think, proceed with the next slide, next presentation. I think Dr. Muhsin Yıldız Hocam will going to proceed. Yes, now. Determination of effects different low-dose gamma rays in fresh bean cultivars under water-deficient conditions. We are going to listen to Dr. Muhsin. Okay. Hocam sesinizi almıyoruz. Mikrofon kapalı.
Merhabalar hocam.
Merhabalar. Hocam buyurun. Bir de... tamam hocam.
Sayın Oturum Başkanım, değerli katılımcılar, bu yıl 5. düzenlenen 5. Uluslararası Avrasya Tarım Kongresi kapsamında farklı fasulye çeşitlerinde, farklı gam aşın dozlarına maruz bırakılan fasulye çeşitlerinde farklı kısıtlı sulama koşullarının etkisinin belirlenmesi adlı sunumumu sizinle paylaşmak istiyorum. Değerli katılımcılar, en çok tercih edilen fasulye türü olan Felis vulgaris, bilimsel ve ekonomik açıdan en çok tercih edilen bir fasulye türüdür. Tüm fasulye türleri içerisinde %90'lık kısmı oluşturmaktadır. Dünya üzerindeki toplam üretime baktığımızda 26.981.784 ton olup Türkiye 4. sırada yer almakta. Türkiye'den hemen sonra Fransa, öncesinde Hindistan, Endonezya ve en yüksek miktarı Çin üretmektedir. Fasulye önemli bir besin deposudur. Tıbbi ve sanayide kullanımının yanı sıra İnsan ve hayvan beslenmesinde de önemli bir yere sahiptir. Diğer bitkilerde olduğu gibi fasulye de olumsuz çevre şartlarına maruz kalmakta. Bu çevre koşulları biyotik ve abiyotik olmak üzere ikiye ayrılmakta. Kuraklık abiyotik stres faktörlerinden biridir. Bitkiyi morfolojik, fizyolojik ve biyokimyasal açıdan önemli oranda etkilemektedir. Nüfusun artması, çevresel kirleticilerin artması, ekilebilir alanların azalması dolayısıyla oluşabilecek ürün kayıplarının azaltılması çok önemlidir. Bu yüzden strese tolerant bitkilerin yeni yöntemlerle geliştirilmesi gerekmektedir. Bu yeni yöntemlerden biri olan gama dozu, elektromanyetik bir dalga olup biyolojik etkilere neden olmaktadır. Bu etkilerden bazıları engelleme, uyarma, mutasyon ve hücre ölümüdür. Gama radyasyonunun ürün üretiminde etkisi dünya çapında birçok araştırmacı tarafından rapor edilmiştir, olumlu etkisi. Bunlardan bazılarını görmektesiniz. Beyaz ve arkadaşları çimlenme ve fide gelişim üzerinde olumlu etki gözlemlemişler. Hüseyin ve arkadaşları yine buna benzer parametrelerde önemli etkiler görmüşler. Yine Marco ve arkadaşları fizyolojik parametrelerde gam aşınlarının olumlu etkisini gözlemlemişlerdir. Maiti ve arkadaşları yine morfolojik ve diğer özelliklerde olumlu etkisini rapor etmişlerdir. Bu çalışmadaki amacımız düşük doz gam aşınlarının erken fide aşamasında fasulye çeşitlerinde etkisini belirlemektir. Kısıtlı sulama koşullarında. Bitkisel materyal olarak Romano ve Gina fasulye çeşitlerini kullandık. Tohumlarımızı Penmak'a ışınlamaya gönderdik. 0, 25, 50 ve 100 olmak üzere 4 gam aşın dozuna maruz bıraktık. Bitkilerimiz 2 ve 3. gerçek yapraklarını oluşturduktan sonra onları kısıtlı sulamaya maruz bıraktık. Fide gelişim parametrelerinin yanı sıra bazı fizyolojik özelliklere de baktık. Bunların yanı sıra besin elementi içeriklerine de bakmış olduk. İstatistiksel analizlerimizi SPSS programı kullanarak yaptık. Duncan çoklu karşılaşma testi ile gruplarımızı karşılaştırdık. Sonuçlarımıza gelmek istiyorum. Çimlenme yüzdesi ve oranlarına baktık farklı fasulye çeşitlerinde. Genel olarak baktığımızda düşük doz gama aşılarının kontrole yakın veya kontrolden daha iyi etki gösterdiğini gözlemlemektesiniz. Dina'da en yüksek değeri 25 grade elde ettik. Romana'da ise en yüksek değeri yine 25 grade elde ettik. 0-5 skalasına baktığımızda 0 ve 50 100 ve 50 grade 100 ve 50 grade Gina'da en yüksek 0-5 skalası değerlerini elde ettik. Romana'da ise bu dozlarda en düşük değerleri elde ettik. Yaprak sayısına baktığımızda Gina'da en yüksek değeri 25 grade, en yüksek değeri 100 grade, en düşük değeri ise kontrol grubunda elde ettik. Romano'ya baktığımızda yine en yüksek değeri 100 grade, en düşük değeri yine kontrolde elde etmiş olduk. Sürgün çapına baktığımızda Gina'da en yüksek değeri 100 gray ve 50 grade elde eder. En yüksek değeri kontrolde, en düşük değeri ise 25 grade elde ettik. Romano'da ise en düşük değeri 50 grade, en yüksek değeri ise 25 grade elde ettik. Değişim oranlarına baktığımızda genel olarak gama dozlarının sürgün çapını Gina'da azalttığını, Romano'da ise 50 grey hariç arttırdığını görmekteyiz. Sürgün uzunluğuna baktığımızda yine genel olarak Romano'da ve Gina'da farklı etkiler gösterdiğini gözlemlemektesiniz. Sürgün yaş ağırlığına baktığımızda yine en yüksek değeri kontrolde, Gina'da kontrolde elde ettik. Artan ışın dozlarıyla birlikte Gina'da sürgün yaş ağırlığının azaldığını görmekteyiz. Romano'da ise farklı sonuçlar elde ettiğimizi söyleyebiliriz. Genel olarak gamma ışın dozlarının Romano ve Gina çeşitlerinde sürgün yaş ağırlığını azalttığını söyleyebiliriz. Sürgün kurul ağırlığına baktığımızda Gina'da en yüksek değer kontrolde, en düşük değer ise 50 grade elde edilmiş. Romano'da en yüksek değer 100 grade, en düşük değer ise 0 grade elde edilmiş. Genel olarak gamma ışın dozlarının sulama koşullarında kök kuru ağırlığını arttırdığını tespit ettik. Yine kök uzunluğuna baktığımızda Romano ve Gina arasında tersi durum söz konusu. Romano'da azalış farklı ışın dozlarının kök uzunluğunu azalttığını, Romano'da Gina'da ise arttırdığını görmekteyiz. Kök yaş ağırlıklarına baktığımızda kontrole oranla Gina'da kök yaş ağırlıklarının azaldığını ve Romano'da daha düşük bir azalış gösterdiğini gözlemlemekteyiz. Kök kuru ağırlıklarına baktığımızda yine Romano ve Gina arasında tersi durumların söz konusu olduğunu görmektesiniz. Artan ışın dozlarıyla birlikte Gina'da kök kuru ağırlıkları artış gösterirken Romano'da ise azalış göstermiştir. Kök sürgün oranlarına baktığımızda genel olarak ikisi için de istatistiksel gamma ışın dozlarının etkisi istatistiksel olarak önemli bulunmamış. Romano'da farklı gamma dozlarının kök sürgün oranını arttırdığını, Romano'da ise azalttığını görmekteyiz. Yaprak oransal su içeriğine baktığımızda Çeşitler arasında farklılık söz konusu. En yüksek değer Dina'da kontrolde elde edilirken Romano'da ise en yüksek değer 100 grade'de elde edilmiştir. Klorofil A miktarına baktığımızda yine Romano ve Dina arasında yine tersi durum söz konusu. Klorofil A miktarını, klorofil A içeriğinin Dina'da gama ışın dozlarıyla birlikte azaldığını, Romano'da ise arttığını görmektesiniz. Klorofil B içeriğine baktığımızda Dina'da kontrol 25 grey ve 50 grey'de eşit miktarda klorofil B olduğunu görmekteyiz. En düşük miktarın yüzde elde ettiğini, yüzde görüldüğünü görmektesiniz. Romano'da yine 0 ve 25 grey eşit çıkmış. Aynı çokluğu karşılaştırma grubunda yer almış. 50 grey en yüksek bulunmuştur. Karotenoid içeriğine baktığımızda Gina'da en yüksek değer kontrolde elde edilirken artan ışın dozuyla birlikte Gina'da karotenoid miktarının azaldığını görmektesiniz. Romano'ya baktığımızda en düşük değer kontrolde, en yüksek değer ise tersi. Yani Gina'nın tersi 100 grey'de elde edildiğini görmektesiniz. Toplam klorofil miktarına baktığımızda Romano'da 25 grey hariç 50 ve 100 grey'de kısıtlı sulamada arttığını, Gina'da ise genel olarak 3 dozda da azaldığını görmektesiniz. MDA içeriğine baktığımızda gama ışın dozlarının kısıtlı sulamada MDA içeriği üzerine etkisi ikisi için de istatistiksel olarak önemli bulunmamış. Ama ikisi için de MDA miktarının azaldığını görmektesiniz. Stres koşullarında MDA miktarının arttığını görmekteyiz normalde. Ama bu çalışmada MDA miktarının azaldığını, yani gamanın MDA miktarını azalttığını görmektesiniz. Besin elementi içeriğine baktığımızda genel olarak stres koşullarının fosfor miktarını azalttığını, Romano'da ise arttırdığını görmektesiniz. Potasyum içeriğine baktığımızda 100 grey'in 100 potasyum içeriğine baktığımızda ise en yüksek değerin kontrol grubunda, yani 0 grey'de elde edildiğini, en düşük değerin ise 50 grey'de elde edildiğini görmektesiniz. Romano'ya baktığımızda ise en düşük değerin 0 ve 25 grey'de elde edildiğini, en yüksek değerin ise 50 grey'de elde edildiğini görmektesiniz. Kalsiyum içeriğine baktığımızda ise genel olarak sulama koşullarında Gina'da kalsiyum içeriğinin azaltıldığını, Romano'da ise arttırdığını gözlemlemektesiniz. Magnezyum içeriğine baktığımızda ise genel olarak en yüksek değerin Gina'da 100 grey'de elde edildiğini, en düşük değerin ise 25 grey'de elde edildiğini, Romano'da ise en yüksek değerin 50 grey'de, en düşük değerin ise kontrol grubunda elde edildiğini görmekteyiz. Bakır içeriğine baktığımızda ikisi arasında yine Gina ve Romano'da ikisinin de stres koşullarında bakır miktarını arttırdığını görmektesiniz. Gina'da %20 gibi bir oranın arttığını, bakır içeriğinin arttığını görmektesiniz. Romano'da ise bu değerin %11 civarlarında olduğunu gözlemlemektesiniz. Mangan içeriğine baktığımızda Cina'da en yüksek değer 125.07 olmak üzere kontrol grubunda, en düşük değer ise 100 greyde %10.11 olmak 110.11 olarak tespit edilmiştir. Romano'da en yüksek değer 50 greyde, en düşük değer ise kontrol grubunda elde edilmiştir. Demir içeriğine baktığımızda gamanın ikisi üzerinde de istatistik etkisi istatistiki olarak önemli bulunmamış ama ikisinde de demir içeriğinin azaldığını yine görmekteyiz. Çinko'da da iki çeşide de baktığımızda Cina'da 25 grey hariç Romano ve Cina'nın ikisinde de bakır miktarının arttığını, çinko miktarının arttığını görmektesiniz. Yine sodyuma baktığımızda her ikisi için de gama dozunun etkisinin istatistiki olarak önemli bulunmadığı Romano'da ve Cina'nın her ikisinde de sodyum miktarının azaldığını görmektesiniz. Çalışmamızda elde ettiğimiz sonuçlara göre morfolojik özellikler üzerinde 100 grey'in en iyi etki gösterdiğini, fizyolojik ve besin elementi içeriklerinde ise 50 grey'in en iyi etki gösterdiğini görmekteyiz. Ayrıca Romano çeşidi üzerine gamaşın dozlarının daha pozitif etki gösterdiğini görmekteyiz. 50 grey'in gama ve 50 grey'in Cina ve Romano'nun iki çeşidi için de daha etkili doz olduğunu tespit ettik. gelecekte bu tür çalışmaların biyokimyasal ve moleküler temelde etkinliğinin araştırılmasını, farklı abiyotik stres faktörleri üzerine araştırılmasını tavsiye ediyoruz. Beni dinlediğiniz için teşekkür ederim.
Okay. Thank you very much Muhsin Hocam. It is an interesting study. Now we are going to proceed a very interesting work, Dr. Paulina Flores. She is going to present selective defoliation by sheep according to herbage mass and plant species in a naturally degraded posture. We are going to listen Dr. Paulina. Muhsin Hocam, paylaşımı kapatırsanız ekran
paylaşım. Beni dinlediğiniz için çok teşekkür ediyorum. Buyurun hocamızı dinleyelim.
Bir dakika kapatayım. Teşekkürler.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon to everybody. Well, I'm Paulina Flores. I'm a professor assistant in a university in the Chilean Patagonia, in Aysén University. So from here, I hope you enjoy this Congress and of course, all the presentations. So thank you very much. Please let me know if you are seeing my presentation, please.
I see it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Well, let's start it. Well, this is a study that we made in collaboration with different institutions in Chile and also with a New Zealander institution. So it was part of a big project of many years. So this is one little part, but it's a really important for us thinking about it in pasture and the different rate of degradation that we have in Chile. Well, the pasture in the south of Chile are the main forage resource to livestock. There are 1.3 million of hectares a total of 48% of the naturalized pasture are under grazing and do not receive any type of management to compensate the soil nutrients deficiencies. To alleviate these constraints, strategies such as pasture management will increase pasture production. On the other hand, grazing animals have a great impact on pasture productivity because they stimulate the tillering of perennial grasses. The animals in general can be very selective between species, and also they are selective between parts of plants, increasing also at the same time pasture quality. Now, the intensive control grazing provide a dense herbage mass and delaying the ability of flat weeds to invade. The chip have the ability to select between species and their extractors, and even may select with higher nutritional value and digestibility. The objective of this work was evaluate the grazing behavior by sheep in naturalized degraded pasture in south of Chile, which had received 3 years of fertilizers and intensive sheep grazing. The study was located at Santa Rosa Research Station of Austral University of Chile in Valdivia City. There were two treatments, naturalized, not fertilized pasture and naturalized, fertilized pasture. Fertilizers and lime were applied annually to correct soil nutrients deficiencies during 3 years. Each pasture plot was grazed by 25 2-year-old sheep. Each grazing event went for 6 hours per day. Each treatment were grazed at the same time when the pasture herbage mass reached an equivalent of 2,100 to 2,300 kgs dry matter per hectare until 1,200 kgs dry matter per hectare. The selective grazing evaluation was carried out during the second year since the pasture started being improved. Three fixed transects of 15 meters along were placed in each plot, along in each transect, every 0.75 meters, and individual tiller of Lolium perenne and Bromus valdivianus, or a plant of Leontodon nudicaulis was marked using a color paper clip, which was attached to the soil by a nail. The marker tillers and plants were in a sequence following the same pattern along each transect. A total of 7 individual marker tillers or plants for each species was marked in each transect. Pre and post grazing, the nails were found using a metal detector, allowing the identification of each tiller plant mark. The statistical analysis, however, the treatment effects were analyzed according to a randomized complete block design with factorial arrangement of the treatments with 2 types of packs of pasture and 3 species within each type of pasture. To determine statistical differences between treatments, analysis of variance was performed. To further analysis, LSD was applied to compare treatment means. Each pasture species data were analyzed separately using a generalized linear model with a binomial distribution, using the SAS program, which indicated significant differences between the species. Well, the results, the pasture produced significant difference among the herbage mass consistently during the whole evaluation. No fertilizer pasture had significantly lower herbage mass production than fertilizer pastures. The highest growth rate were reached in the early October. All pasture had their lowest growth during summer and winter. Now, the grassing probability in fertilizer pasture was greater in Lorium perenne, and in no fertilized pasture, Leontodon ludicaulis was the most grazed. In both pastures, Leontodon ludicaulis was the most intake. Well, considering the 3 years of evaluation, fertilizer pasture showed a positive effect on management and fertilizers due to fertilizer pasture had more available soil nutrients as consequence of fertilizers and pasture management. The lamina length of Lorium perenne and Bromus valdivianus was greater than Leontodon ludicaulis in autumn, winter, and spring. Leontodon ludicaulis present a significantly longer lamina length during summer because Lorium perenne and Bromus valdivianus reduced their lamina length in response to water stress. And to finally, the conclusions, fertilizations and intensive chip grassing naturalized degraded pastures increase the herbage mass production. Chip actively select the species of plants to be grazed with a marked preference to Lorium perenne and Bromus valdivianus in fertilized pastures. And when the herbage mass was increased, and the otherwise, when the herbage mass was low and under water stress condition, sheep increased the grassing selection in Leontodon ludicaulis. Thank you very much. And for this end of the presentation, this is a picture of my city where I live at the moment. So thank you very much for all the organizer and for this really important space for all the researchers around the world. Thank you very much.
Also, thank you very much. It is a very interesting subject, actually, and it was a very good presentation. If we are going to have any questions, I'm going to ask them at the end of the session. So if I didn't take any questions, so I'm going to proceed. Now, next, we are going to listen to Emine Yurteri Hocam. Dr. Emine Yurteri is going to present investigation of propagation possibilities of Thymus anxanthium with tissue culture.
Thank you very much, sir. I will do the representation in behalf of Emine Yurteri.
Sorry, I'm. Let me introduce you.
We are sorry. We didn't inform you about that. We are sorry. Okay.
Haydar Küplemez Hocam is going to represent the work. Let's listen it.
Sorry, I will share the representation now. Sorry, there is a problem with the computer. I am one of
you. We have time, we can wait. It's not a problem.
Okay. Can you see the representation right now?
Yes, we are now.
Okay. Dear participants, I would like to make a representation about investigation of propagation possibilities of Thymus precox, also named as Anser Thyme with tissue culture. My name is Haydar Küplemez. I am a research assistant in Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University, Faculty of Agriculture, Field Crops Department in Rize Province, Turkey. Especially our research areas are medicinal plants with quality analysis and their their propagation and reproduction. The Eastern Black Sea region has an important place in terms of plant species, especially medicinal and high commercial value species among these plants requires attention to the plants of the region and especially the plants belonging to the Lamiaceae family. Because when we talk about medicinal plants, Lamiaceae family is very important, very rich family, and consisting of many genus. Also, species of Lamiaceae family used in folk medicine in the region, apart from being used in industry, in addition, it is used as a raw drug. We mean a plant itself as a raw drug. Raw drug means unprocessed plant. For example, we take the plant out from the soil and use it. It is a raw drug. In the form of condiments and spices, increases its importance even more. There is a map of the Eastern Black Sea when compared in the map of Turkey. There are 222 endemic species around 2,239 plant species in the Black Sea region. I think it is the third region when we talk about richness about the plant species. The Eastern Black Sea region is widely known as it is high altitude mountains. Usually they are up to 2,000 meters. When we talk about altitude, Anser Thyme, Thymus precox, it is a subspecies of Caucasian, Caucasus, because our region is a geographical region in Caucasians, is named after the Anser Plateau. Anser Plateau is located in Rize, a very famous place about tourism and plant species, which is located in the Eastern Black Sea region in Turkey. It is a member of the genus Thymus, which has 41 species in Turkey, 24 of which are endemic. It is a very high rate of endemism. As these plants are widely found in the Anser district of Rize province, fresh and dried thyme leaves are locally called Anser tea. Usually local people use this plant for making tea. Besides being used as a herbal tea, it is also well known as a traditional medicine for the treatment of stomach ache, headache, influenza, gout, and high cholesterol. Because of colorful and aromatic flowers, honeybees extensively visit this plant. The people living in the region believe that Anser honey, famous for its healing properties, has curative effects on pharyngitis, tonsillitis, ulceration, wounds, and scratches. Based on the above considerations, I think it is important to mention about this issue. Anser honey, there is a debate on the Anser honey. Some scientists say that bees are especially take pollen from the Thymus precox. And some researchers suggest that bees take the pollen, take nectar from one of the plants in this Anser plateau, and it is called Anser honey. but it is widely used in traditional medicine, so people believe that it is beneficial for health. Based on the above considerations, in vitro tissue and cell culture of Thymus procax has never been studied before. Utilizing plant materials which can ensure botanical and chemical stability over the increasing process seems to be of crucial importance. In vitro tissue and cell culture of Thymus procax has never been studied before. In this study, plant propagation of Anserthyme in tissue culture conditions was investigated. We cultured those plants which was collected from the Anzer Plateau in Rize, and it was in our field trial area in our faculty. The plants were harvested on plots located in the field trial area of the Faculty of Agriculture in the Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University. As you can see here, this one was in magenta. The plant materials were washed under the running tap water for 1 hour after harvesting. It is a pre-sterilization treatment. Afterwards, the root, stem, and leaf parts are taken into separate containers in the sterile cabinet, and it was treated with 70% ethanol for 5 minutes. Also, it is a pre-sterilization treatment. Then it was kept in 2020 for 15 minutes and rinsed with sterile distilled water. We use 2020 for the stabilizing process. 2020 helps us stabilizing bacteria and fungi on the explant. We say explant for the plant material in tissue culture. And then after the stabilization process, sterilization was completed using 20%. It is a commercial bleach for 20, 10, and 5 minutes, followed by rinsing them 3 times with sterile distilled water for 5 minutes. Sorry for the mistake. It is not the seeds, it is plantlets. Plantlets were planted to the MS medium, because those are plantlets, not the seeds. Sorry for the mistake. Supplemented with 30 grams sucrose and 7.5 gram to liter agar, including 5 plantlets of each petri dish. In order to, it was 20 treatment, because we can understand it from the bubbles. And this application, this treatment was in the commercial bleach. It is the sterilization process. I'm in the left photo. In order to induce plant regeneration, 1 milligram to liter kinetin and 1 milligram to liter kinetin plus 0.1 NNA. It is a naphthalene acetic acid. It is an auxin. We use the auxins in tissue culture to induce plant regeneration with the stokinin treatments, because it has to be in a balance when we desire to induce the plant regeneration. MS medium without any plant growth regulators was preferred as a control group. So control group is S1, just kinetin treatment is S2, and kinetin combined with the NAA, so naphthalene acetic acid treatment, is S3 treatment. All cultures were incubated at 2 different incubation conditions to induce regeneration. First, explants incubated at 26 Celsius degree. 16 hours light and 8 hours dark conditions, 300 lux light source in growth chamber. In second place, explants were exposed to dark condition at 26 Celsius degree. Results and discussion section. In line with the findings, all plant parts from which the explants were taken showed different responses to the application of plant growth regulators. That's mean we got some desired results from the explants, I mean root, stem, and leaf explants, and their response to plant growth regulators was as we aim to shorter regeneration rate. Considering the percentage of plant regeneration, the highest rates among the plant growth regulator treatments were taken from S3 medium. Because as I said before, when we combined the cytokinin treatment with auxins, we got more high results, but it doesn't work with every plant on this direction. Some plants just can be induced with the only cytokinin treatment, but usually cytokinins and auxins, I mean the plant growth regulators, should be in balance. While the highest percentage of plant regenerations was found to be 51.3% in root explants cultured in S3 medium, the lowest rate was found to be as 5.6% in leaf explants cultured in S1 medium. Figure four. Treatment results. As we can see, the best results we got in root explants in S3 medium. I think root explants has more meristem cells, so they are more regenerate than leaf and stem explants. So when they are treated with a balanced cytokinin and auxin treatment, we get higher results. And then the second higher results was in stem explants in also S3 medium, kinetin combined with NAA. And the lowest results were all in the control medium. So 10% in S1 medium in root, 12.2 in S1 medium in stem, and 5.6% in S1 in the leaf explants. In the table one, there is a number of explants, number of regenerated plants, and the plant regeneration rate. Some number of explants are lower than others because there was some plant material shortage or many that could be a contamination, but it doesn't affect our results because we got the rate of the plant regeneration rate. So as we can see, root explants were more regenerative than the leaf, and stem explants were more regenerative than the leaf explants. So if we can sort out, most regenerative explants were root, then stem, and then the leaf. When we are compared to plant medium, S1 control treatment was has the lowest regeneration rate, as we talked before. And the medium results we get in the 1 mg/L kinetin treatment, and the other was kinetin combined with the NAA treatment. S3 medium found successful in inducing plant regeneration rate in root, stem, and leaf explants, respectively as 51.3%, 40%, and 27.5%. We cannot give any example or any discussion about the ANZER team or Timus Prokaks because it is the first study about tissue culture on this plant. So We have other Timus in vitro regeneration results to discussion. These results are in agreement with a study conducted by Nordin. Researchers reported that kinetin combined with NAA produced better plant regeneration results in Timus hyemalis explants. Also, Kajuria reported that kinetin treatment enhanced plant regeneration in Timus ceruleum. So we can say that kinetin treatment is successful in the genus of Timus, but when combined with NAA treatment as an auxin treatment, we got more better results when we talk about plant regeneration. As a result of our study, it is important to study the rapid reproduction techniques of the Timus procax, so Anzer team, called in Turkish, Anzer kekiği, we say, plant, which is important in terms of active ingredient content that grows in the natural flora of Turkey. Tissue cultures on medicinal plants give us an advantage of taking them into culture. Because when the medicinal plants cultured in the fields, or if their culture in the field is difficult or has some limited factors, we use in vitro tissue culture methods to achieve them. And we have some stable plant production limits, for example, same ingredients, because culturing medicinal plants has more advantage than collecting them from the nature. If they are has a commercial value, we think that culturing them in the fields has more advantage. Also, it is good for the plant population in the nature for their future. It is the first study in terms of investigation in vitro plant regeneration in Timus procax, some subspecies, Caucasus, variety Caucasus. Also, it is thought to be the study could be beneficial in terms of reducing the duration of breeding studies and contribute to micropropagation of medicinal plants by using in vitro methods and contributing to other researches. Thank you very much for listening. If you have any questions on this paper, on this presentation, I am very eager to listen to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, if we have any question, we have time. If we are going to take questions from the audience, I'm going to ask them at the end of the presentation session. I will check if we have questions. Now we don't have. Thank you very much. This is a very interesting topic because this team is an endemic to Turkey and it is very important health beneficial traits. So it is important to work with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for all listening. Thank you. Can I stop the share?
Yes, I think. We have not too much time, so I am going to, get faster. And now I'm going to make a presentation, so let me share my screen. Okay, we have 20 minutes. I think you can see my presentation, so I'm going to be fast. Is it okay? You can see it? Okay, let's start. The title of the work is Converting a Highly Accurate Predefined HRM Protocol to CAPS Assay for Selecting TVR1 Resistant Allele in Lettuce. This is a work we did with Dr. Ayşe Özgür Uncu. As you listen, a very good presentation about the obscurata carrot before. So it is a molecular-based research we conduct in lettuce. Lettuce is an important plant species horticultural crop. It is not a staple crop, but it is important in health beneficial part and also the economical part. So it is a diploid plant species. It has 18 chromosomes. Lettuce can grow in moderate climates. So it is, we can say that in most of the world, you can grow on lettuce and of course different types. Also it can be consumed as raw salad or sandwich fillings. In the means of production, China is the first one. So it is normal. Most of the horticulture crops, we see this table. And then United States and India. Also Turkey is around Italy. What is our main concern in this work? Diabetic disease. Diabetic disease is a soil diabetic disease caused by a soil-borne virus. Actually, it is a family, very close related family. One of the tomato bichette stunt virus, the other one is lettuce necrotic stunt virus. Both of them can make this disease. It is an, you can see from the picture, you can see the effect of this disease. In lettuce, it is important to make breeding, resistance breeding through the molecular markers because it makes it faster. As we know, it's a marker selection approach. So it is important to find the genetic basis of the resistance. This work is conducted by Simco et al. At 2009. It is a wonderful work. They make an association mapping study and they find the exact locus. They find the genetic basis of the resistance. So we are going to a little bit talk about this. There is a single dominant gene, this TBR1. It's responsible for the diabetic resistance. It is the genetic basis coming from the iceberg type lettuce. So they conduct this study as a susceptible and the diabetic resistant plant, and they make a recombinant inbred lines and they make association mapping by using SNP markers and they find the exact position of the TBR1 gene. And they generate two SNPs. Also, they generate HRM assay to marker selection purposes. What we did, we convert this HRM protocol to a CAPS assay. Why we did this? Because, as you know, HRM technique, high resolution melting technique, is a very powerful strategy for SNP genotyping, but there is a little bit concerns about it. First of all, if you are doing HRM, you have to expertise on it. And also you need a real-time PCR. So it is a comparatively expensive work. So if you are going to use HRM analysis, you are going to also need higher advanced molecular biology equipment. But CAPS assay is a simple strategy, also very powerful strategy, also cheaper, half cheaper. If you compare with the HRM assays, it is like HRM assay per plant is $10. The other one is 40, 45 cents. So it is very cheap if you compare it. So it is very reliable. But the most important part of it, it can suit all basic molecular biology equipped laboratories. So if you are dealing with the plant breeding programs, so you are not going probably most of the laboratories, especially developing or undeveloped countries, they don't have real-time PCRs. Also, if they have, maybe they cannot run it for the big population. So we generate a CAPS assay. CAPS assay, what we did, you can see that TVR1 gene locus, there is two important SNP markers. These SNP markers can explain the phenotype, resistance phenotype. We make a position mapping, restriction mapping of these SNPs. The C allele of that SNP allele of C cytosine is related to susceptibility, and the T allele of that gene is diabetic resistance. So if we make that resistance allele, if we can see a pattern divergence with the enzyme, let's see from here, you can see that BCC1 enzyme recognize this SNP part, it's cytosinolid, so it may restrict the PCR product. On the other hand, if it is T, the restriction recognition site is disrupted, so BCC1 restriction enzyme cannot detect it, so we cannot digest the PCR product. It is the basic CAPS assay. For the other SNP, it is the 72 position of that gene. It is again same. If it is cytosine, it is diabetic susceptible. If it is timin, diabetic resistance phenotype. It is 100% phenotypical association. So if it is cytosine C, you can say that this plant is susceptible. If it is T, then it is going to be a resistant plant. You can select the lettuce by this assay. So then we generate two distinct CAPS assays for both of these SNPs. You can see position 54 and position 72. These two SNPs can serve well with the laboratory trial. It was an in silico approach first, then we make it laboratory approach. As you can see, if it is T, it is resistant, so you couldn't see any digestion with the 54 SNP position. And if it is C, it's susceptible, you see a homozygous cut. If the heterozygous plant, you are going to see homozygous uncut PCR products, so you are going to see two homozygously digested PCR products. As you can see for the second of the CAPS assay, we are going to see also it is working good in the laboratory. Also, you can separate homozygote resistant plant to homozygote susceptible plant. Also, if you have a heterozygous plant, you are going to see three bands with the SNP profiling. So our purpose is generate a marker selection procedure. Already discovered HRM assay, be it converted to CAPS assay. It's a cheaper and also easier approach. You can easily follow the protocol, and you can even select the resistant allele by gel electrophoresis. That's it. Let me stop sharing. This is my presentation, our work. These are the important references. Also, we are grateful for Simco and their group because they generate this perfect essay. Let me stop sharing. Okay, it is end of my representation. We don't have too much time, so I have to proceed. Next, presentation, we are going to listen to Müşerref Kibar Hocam, morphological characterization of some qualified melanin genotypes and heterotic groups. Let's listen.
Hi, everybody. My name is Müşerref Kibar from Konya of Turkey. I am a master's student in the Faculty of Agriculture, Department of Plant Breeding and Genetics in Selçuk University. This is my first conference presentation. Today, I am going to talk about the morphological characterization of some qualified melon genotypes and heterotic groups. My presentation consists of introduction, material and methods, result and discussion, conclusion and questions. The origin and time of melons are uncertain, And it has been reported that they split from the East Europe at the end of the at the end of the 15th century. Melons are widely grown and very valuable product. Climatic and geopolitical conditions may cause delays in the split of melons. Melon is a fruit that is grown mostly in the field and in some cases under cover. In 2019, melons are grown on average of 10,094 hectares in the world. While China ranks first with 379,788 hectares of melon cultivation, Turkey ranks second with 79,250 hectares. In terms of cultivation area, Turkey is well above the world average. In terms of production, the world average is 261,907,710 tons, while China ranks with first 13,489,373 tons. Turkey ranks second with 1,777,059 tons. In terms of yield per unit area, the world average is 203.324 hectograms per hectare. China ranks 19 with a yield of 355.182 hectograms per hectare, and Turkey ranks 30-50 with a yield of 224.235 hectograms per hectare. Despite incentive melon cultivation in Turkey, it lags behind many countries in terms of yield per unit area, although it is above the world average. The reason for the yield differences between melon varieties are due to genetics and environment. Conducting research based on morphological measurements on different melon genotypes in different regions creates a good infrastructure for genetic studies. The aim of the study is to determine the morphological characteristic of some qualified melon from heterotic groups. The experiment was carried out in the research and application plot of the Faculty of Agriculture, Selçuk University. 56 Salfing II melon genotypes were used in the study. Different measurements were made on fruit and seed, fruit weight, fruit length, fruit diameter, fruit stem length, fruit peduncle thickness, seeds of pistil scar, flesh thickness of fruit, ring thickness of fruit, total soluble soil content, and power of hydrogen values were determined in fruits. In seeds, the weight of 1,000 seeds and the number of seeds per fruit were determined. All the data obtained to determine the relationship between genotypes of the examined traits were made by using the Ward method in the GMP program for cluster analysis. Again, with the same program for factor analysis was performed with principal component analysis. As a result of the research, some introductory statistical values of the future empirized are given in the table one. According to this table, fruit weight was found to be a minimum of 1196 gr, a maximum of 4,288 gr, an average of 2,663.14 gr. Fruit length was found to be a minimum of 13.54 centimeter, a maximum of 27.28 centimeter, and an average of 20.21 centimeters. Fluid diameter was found to be a minimum of 11.46 centimeters, a maximum of 20.9 centimeters, and an average of 17.30 centimeters. The total soluble soil content volume in fluid was found to be a minimum 4.48%, maximum 11.04%, and average 7.744%. The minimum value of 1,000 seed weight was 21.68 gr, the maximum 57.38 gram gr, and the average 45.47 gr. Eigen values of fruit weight, fruit length, fruit diameter, and fruit stem length were found as 3.8940, 1.9925, 1.3829, and 1.2827 respectively. The shares of these features in the total variation were determined as 32,450, 16,604, 11,525, and 10,619 respectively. It was determined that the first and four main components from the table to explained 60,579% and 71,268% of the total variation respectively.
Şerif Hocam, 2 dakikamız var. Kusura bakmayın, kapanacakmış.
According to table 3, the characteristic include in PCA 1, PCA 2, PCA 3, and PCA 4 with the highest volume were determined as fruit size, fruit stem thickness, total soluble soil content, and power of hydrogen respectively. As a result of the cluster analysis, it was determined that 56 genotypes formed 4 different clusters. In conclusion, it was determined that 56 melon genotypes formed 4 different clusters. It is thought that there is sufficient variation among the genotypes evaluated in this study in terms of the feature emphasized, and some genotypes can be used in the future studies. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ms. Şeref Hocam. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but we don't have too much time. We have around 1 minute. It is the end of our session. It is a hard time. Everybody is feeling that it's a COVID-19 pandemic, but we are grateful for the organization committee. They give a very nice platform. We hear very interesting and important oral presentations, important works. And it is wonderful to hear from Chile. It is always pleased. And we are also very important. We listen very important subjects, but I'm sorry we don't have time. So I think we are going to see each other next international congress. If you have something to say, we have around 30 minutes.
Seconds, I think.
Sorry.
So. Thank you.
Oh, okay, then thank you very much for all for your participations. Also, it is very important a congress in agriculture. We hear interesting words, interesting studies. So, I think we are going to close it. Thank you very much again.
Thank you very much.
Hopefully seeing each other in better situations without the pandemic world. Maybe face to face.
inşallah.
İnşallah. See you.
Bye.
Bye.